വിദേശ വിചാരത്തിൻ്റെ മറ്റൊരധ്യായത്തിലേക്ക് സ്വാഗതം. ഇന്ത്യയിൽ പുതിയ ഗവൺമെൻറ് ഉണ്ടായതിന് ശേഷം ഇന്ത്യ അമേരിക്കൻ ബന്ധങ്ങളിൽ പുതിയ പുരോഗതി ഉണ്ടാകാൻ സാധ്യത കാണുന്നു. പ്രധാനമന്ത്രി മോദിക്ക് വിസ നിഷേധിച്ച കാലമൊക്കെ മറന്നു കഴിഞ്ഞിരിക്കുന്നു. ഇന്ത്യ അമേരിക്കൻ ബന്ധങ്ങൾ നല്ലതാകണം, ശക്തമാകണം എന്നാഗ്രഹിക്കുകയാണ് രണ്ടു രാജ്യങ്ങളും. പ്രധാനമന്ത്രി മോദിയുടെ അമേരിക്കൻ സന്ദർശനത്തിനുള്ള തീയതികൾ നിശ്ചയിച്ചു കഴിഞ്ഞിരിക്കുന്നു. മുൻപുണ്ടായിരുന്ന പ്രശ്നങ്ങളെല്ലാം മാറ്റിക്കൊണ്ട് പുതിയ ഒരു ഇന്ത്യ അമേരിക്കൻ ബന്ധം സ്ഥാപിക്കാനുള്ള ശ്രമമാണിപ്പോൾ നടക്കുന്നത്. ഇതെങ്ങനെയാണ് അമേരിക്കക്കാർ കാണുന്നത്? വിശേഷിച്ചും അമേരിക്കയിലെ ഇന്ത്യക്കാർ അവരെങ്ങനെയാണ് ഇന്ത്യ അമേരിക്കൻ ബന്ധങ്ങളെ കാണുന്നത്? അവിടുത്തെ ഇന്നത്തെ സ്ഥിതിവിശേഷം എന്താണ്? സാമ്പത്തിക സ്ഥിതിയായാലും രാഷ്ട്രീയ സ്ഥിതിയായാലും പ്രസിഡൻ്റ് ഒബാമയുടെ പ്രശസ്തിയായാലും ഒക്കെ എങ്ങനെയാണ് ഇന്നത്തെ അമേരിക്കൻ സ്ഥിതിവിശേഷം? ഇതൊക്കെ ചർച്ച ചെയ്യാനായി നമ്മോടൊപ്പം ഇന്ത്യക്കാരനായ തിരുവനന്തപുരത്തുകാരനായ മിസ്റ്റർ ലാനി പീറ്റേഴ്സ് ഉണ്ട്. അദ്ദേഹം ഒരു ഡോക്ടറാണ്, അതിനുശേഷം ഒരു ബാങ്കറായി ഇപ്പോൾ ജനങ്ങൾക്ക് സേവനം ചെയ്യുന്ന ഒരു പ്രസ്ഥാനവും തുടങ്ങിയിട്ടുണ്ട്. അദ്ദേഹം അമേരിക്ക ഇന്ത്യ ബന്ധങ്ങളിൽ ഒരു പ്രധാന പങ്ക് വഹിക്കുന്ന വ്യക്തി കൂടിയാണ്. താങ്ക് യു ലാനി പീറ്റേഴ്സ്.
താങ്ക് യു സോ മച്ച് ഫോർ ഹാവിംഗ് മീ.
ഗുഡ് ടു സീ യു ഹിയർ. വെൽ, ഹൗ ഡസ് യുണൈറ്റഡ് സ്റ്റേറ്റ്സ് ലുക്ക് അറ്റ് ദി ന്യൂ ഗവൺമെൻറ് ഇൻ ഇന്ത്യ? ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് വിത്ത് ഹോപ്പ്, ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് വിത്ത് ഡൗട്ട്സ് ഓർ വിത്ത് ഹാപ്പിനെസ്?
ഐ ബിലീവ് ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് വിത്ത് എ ലോട്ട് ഓഫ് ഹോപ്പ്. ദർ ഹാസ് ബീൻ എ ചേഞ്ച് ഇൻ ദി അപ്രോച്ച് ടു not only United States to foreigners as a whole, and we hope the words will be followed through by actions. We will have to wait and see for the next 6 months.
There is a new sense of purpose in the new government. Is that how you see it?
I do believe so. There is an eagerness to develop trust. Indian who lives in United States, I believe this is could be a new era,
right,
for openness and creating that trust. People can travel freely, can invest with confidence, and have the sense that India has opened a new chapter.
But even the previous government was very keen to have good relations with the United States. What happened were kind of some international developments. The economic situation in the world itself was an issue. Then we had this nuclear issue, immigration problems came up, and we could not fulfill some of the expectations that the United States had about India. And similarly, India had suspicions about the United States' intentions. So can these all be removed in one go?
I think it's going to take time. We are moving in the right direction for the first reason that we have an absolute majority in the parliament,
right,
that gives a mandate for the prime minister to act in a way that is effective and do not have to consult many other bodies. So that brings up a new era. And of course, the way the U.S., I'm a U.S. citizen, we look at Indian opportunities is Indian government, the levels of bureaucracy, is that going to hurt us, or this is just going to be another way of serving the same food it has been done before?
No, but many people compare Obama with Modi, or the other way around, because Obama also came from non-traditional background, shall we say. He broke new grounds by becoming the president, and there was a lot of hope. There was a lot of the change was the clarion call, as it were, which brought Obama to power. But looking back at his tenure, would you say that he has fulfilled those expectations?
President Obama has always had good intentions, but he was also handicapped by not having the support of Congress.
Right.
By United States Constitution, all three bodies have to agreed to be effective.
Right.
And he didn't get that support.
He didn't get bipartisan support. The Republicans did not give him any support.
That is correct.
Well, so here also it could be a similar situation in that sense, because Prime Minister Modi has no majority in the Rajya Sabha. So even though he has a huge majority in the Lok Sabha, he may still have to be patient in negotiating with the opposition. So it may happen in the, like in the case of Obama, here also there could be a certain amount of disappointment on that score. But certainly we look forward to good India-US relations. But somehow in the second term of Obama, he did not seem to have given it as much attention as he did in the first. After 2010, when he visited India, things have been going rather badly. So why do you think it will get better now?
It will get better because the message that has been sent to the country, to the United States, has been different, that there is going to be an openness.
Right.
And there is going to be inclusive of all religions, for that matter. You know,
yes, it was on that issue that Mr. Modi was denied a visa, saying that he has been persecuting religious minorities. Anyway, that's all been put behind us. But the political system, what is the big difference between the American system and here? Of course, it is a presidential system, and here it is different. You have been in American politics.
I have.
So how do you distinguish the two ways of dealing with the people and the political system as such?
Well, the first, America has a two-part, basically a two-party system.
Right.
And so you have to either be in one
a Republican
party or the
or a
other.
Democrat, yes.
Yeah, there is no other way. Another one person can come from nowhere.
Right.
But India has the luxury of having many parties, and many times we have a coalition government.
For quite a few
quite
years.
Quite a few
now.
Years. And that creates some degree of ineffectiveness. Mm. You know, people cannot seem to make it go in one direction. Either are we for free enterprise system? If so, we have to embrace it. We can be halfway socialism and halfway capitalism.
Right.
And that has been one of the problems that we have had between the two countries. You know, China, on the other hand, example, although they have a fundamentally communist government, they have a very, very thriving free market
well,
system.
After 1972, after the Nixon visit,
yes.
Things had changed dramatically.
Free, thriving, people have no issue investing dollars in the Chinese economy. But they have the confidence and they can get their dollars and profits back, whether to Australia or to New Zealand or back to UK.
But about India, that confidence
that's
is not
absolutely
there?
Absolutely not there. Mm-hmm. The bureaucracy is absolutely.
But
horrendous.
That is more recent. There was a time when the Americans were very enthusiastic.
It was. They tested the waters.
Yes.
But for even now, for example, you can't do any investment without Reserve Bank agreeing.
Clearances, yeah.
And then you have to agree on certain amount of investment.
And also these huge scams that were reported.
Right.
Would that would also affected your confidence in India?
That is true.
Mm-hmm.
And even though you may give in a company a minority ownership, but that has to be true and can be validated. If it is 20% ownership, that 20% ownership should be validated correctly. And the government should stand behind it. So that is the barrier that we need to move in order for and have free flow of technology, of service industry. India is fortunate to have two or three things. One, we as a country speak English, which is very good,
right.
As opposed to Chinese economy. Two, we are fairly intellectual people. And although we are introverts, we're very good at computers.
Right.
And therefore, the technology is there. So we have an educated, young, technology savvy community.
But what you need is a more liberal economy. And you expect that Prime Minister Modi will deliver that. Is that the expectation?
That's what we expect.
Mm-hmm.
And for the and there's a 12-hour difference between, say, New York and Delhi.
Yes. So we can work while you sleep
exactly.
And vice versa.
That is a God's blessing.
Right.
We can go to sleep while our counterpart here in Delhi or in India is working.
Mm-hmm.
And in the morning, all the information is on my desktop.
The processing can be done here.
Very well. But also,
speaking about politics, you have raised funds for politicians. Which party have you been supporting?
I have worked with both parties. I have raised funds for President Clinton, George Bush, and John McCain, I'm a non-partisan kind of person.
Right.
I look at the individual and see who can do best.
This is a major difference between the American system and here. Here, if you have raised funds for a politician, you will never talk about it. Neither the politician nor you. But in the American system, when you raise funds for a politician, everything is open, it is legitimate. And then you have a stake in that administration. And sometimes you are rewarded for it. I know people who have been appointed ambassadors because they have raised funds for the presidential candidate. How does that work, since you know both the countries?
It is more transparent and fluid in that.
And there's a system.
There's a system in place so that you can raise certain amount of funds for a person, and that could be somewhat unlimited.
Mm-hmm. Raise means what? Host dinners.
Yes.
You pay $2,000 per plate, and then the president comes and takes some photographs with
it's
you.
It's as high as $38,000 per plate.
Per plate.
The highest that went per plate in New York recently.
Right, right.
So, and that would be reasonable because you report.
Mm. Everything is transparent.
Mm.
And who pays the tax? Or you already pay the tax before you spend that money? Or is it the candidate who pays the tax?
No, it's after tax dollars.
Okay, all right.
It's after. But there's also other ways. So that's individual contribution. Then there is called the Political Action Committees, PAC.
Right, yes.
PACs are set up for certain purpose. And they may have a belief in, say, the interest would be a PAC created for better India-U.S. relationship. That's all their motive is.
Mm.
And that PAC would pick a candidate and would support them. So you get to present your information, present your arguments to any one person in the administration.
And then you can work as a lobby for that. Even after he becomes president, you become a lobbyist and you take up causes which you take up with the president. That is how it works, right?
It does.
There are all these Jewish lobbies there and huge sums of money. And they are able to influence decision making in the White House.
Right.
Indian community has been trying this for a while, I know. But I don't think we have reached that level of influence, have we?
We have not.
Mm.
Yeah.
But during the nuclear deal, yes, many of these groups worked very well.
Yeah. But Indians are not so united in that area.
Right.
Yeah.
It's very difficult to get a single leadership.
Yeah. Mm. Because of the nature of our Indian
our diversity we carry.
You know, when this is what is the amazing thing about India is how we remain united, having very little common ground between a Tamil person and a Malayali.
Mm-hmm.
But we still are united, and that is an enigma for many
foreigners. United in the larger sense.
Yes.
But when it comes to, I have lived in the United States, worked with the Indian community. It's always very difficult to have a unified leadership for the whole country. That has been a major challenge. Everyone works in groups, becomes leaders, and then difficult to make them coordinate. But there have been some occasions where the Indian community has worked very well for the sake of India. Like, for example, the Congressional Caucus on India. You must be aware of that.
Right.
About 115 congressmen. Automatically, they would vote for Indian causes. And that is because of the Indian-American community, which has been raising funds for them and asking them to vote in such a way that is supportive of India.
Yes.
And that experience you must have.
Right. It would be a good cost to take to expand that PAC,
mm-hmm.
because PACs have the political as well as the legal mandate,
right,
to work in any direction they want to work at.
Well, one disadvantage we have in the United States is the Pakistan PACs are also equally influential.
Right.
In fact, many U.S. leaders used to tell us that you cannot influence too much because Pakistani influence comes and finally it comes to a zero because it's a zero-sum game.
Right.
Both are trying.
Right.
So that is one disadvantage we have.
Yes.
Because Pakistani community is also very active in lobbying for their causes. And that is why continuously Pakistan seems to get better attention than we do, and also because of strategic reasons. Anyway, coming to President Obama, what do you think are his possibilities in the remaining years of his presidency? Is he going to do something big like the Obamacare? You are a doctor, so you must be interested in that. And how is he going to carry it through?
President Obama is a visionary.
Mm-hmm.
He has a fundamental belief in having healthcare for everyone. So that's his signature.
But why is it so controversial? It should be like motherhood.
It's true. By constitution, United States, it says, if you cannot afford a lawyer, we'll give you one free.
Right.
But if you cannot afford a doctor, you die. So there is no constitutional support for...
But anyone can go into an emergency and get treated.
It's true. There is health care in that respect.
They get Medicare, they get food coupons. In a say, it's a welfare state, isn't it?
Right, but there's still 45 million people without health insurance.
Right.
And therefore, they have no access to primary care or cannot go to a doctor's office.
But why is it then so controversial? Why is it that it is opposed by people?
It is opposed because of the way who would pay for it. If you bring in so many people into the system, they have to have a system to pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
And that has not been well thought through and has not been implemented.
Right.
So it takes 1/5 of the economy. And when you have such a phenomenal or such a big project, all parties will have to put in their opinion before it can be implemented.
Yeah.
I think partly because this is a very new idea, because United States have always gone in the way that there are certain people will be without health insurance.
Actually, it was President Bush who gave the most possible support to India-U.S. relations. And after President Obama came, in fact, it suffered a lot because of the other considerations. But why is it that President Obama has the lowest popularity figures now? He's even lower than President Bush.
It is. I think, although he means well, many of his ideas have not been accepted well. Well, Obamacare is one of the major issues.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the foreign policy issues that he has taken on has not gone well.
But isn't it also part of the fact that the American power itself is diminishing in the world? I mean, everyone recognizes that. So is it President Obama's problem? Like, for example, he wanted to do something in Syria. He could not do that. In other places, he's withdrawing from the world scene, as it were. He's back from Iraq. Now he's being pushed back into Iraq. Afghanistan, he's withdrawing. So the diminishing importance of U.S. as a global power may be affecting his personality as president. Would you agree with that?
Well, we only have one superpower, that is United States.
Yes.
But there is privileges and also responsibilities that comes with it. And one of the responsibility is to use power when there is issues around the world.
Right.
It is almost a responsibility, because everyone looks up to U.S. and say, what are you going to do if something happens in Syria, for example?
Right.
Now, the question comes, how much power? If you use too much power, as we did in Iraq, it's bad. If you do too little power, as we did in Libya, then you're leading from behind. Mm-hmm. So there's difficult to win in either situation. It is true that American power comes from the military industrial complex.
Right.
And that
and research and development.
Right. That industrial complex is getting less and less, because manufacturing is going away, has gone away significantly. Therefore, that strength is diminishing. But there's no one else to fill that vacuum.
Mm-hmm.
And so we are seeing issues where the diminishing power is left unfilled.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an example in Syria, when no one is willing to step up and say, well, this is wrong, killing so many people of
right.
your own people. Although everybody feels it's wrong, if Americans stepped in and used more power, then it would be looked upon as, they are imperialist.
Yeah, but in the past they have got away with it. And
yes.
Now it doesn't seem to, that will does not seem to be there. Like, for example, what is happening in Iraq today is something which is of great concern to the rest of the world. And the U.S. is still hesitating what to do with these, with the Sunni advance into Baghdad. It's becoming...
In Iraq.
So it's becoming an issue. But anyway, coming to the end of our conversation, who do you think the next president would be? Because you always speculate after the first term who the next president is.
I think
about Hillary Clinton.
Hillary Clinton has a well-oiled machine.
Mm-hmm.
They are a political dynasty. On the Republican side, there's still no serious leadership. There are many people looking for that position, but no one is an outstanding leader yet.
But then she has to break another glass ceiling. No woman had ever been president of the United States. So it'll be too many glass ceilings. One, you have just broken that you elected an African American as president. Yes. Are the Americans ready to do another revolution in this area? This is the question.
Unless there is a strong candidate from the Republican side, I think Americans will be ready.
And that'll be good for India, you think? Yeah. You think she is inclined towards better relations with India?
The whole Clinton family is pro-Indian. So.
Right.
Yeah, Bill Clinton has been a big advocate of Indo-US relationship. So I think it will be. But it mostly depends on, I think, how India opens up their trade policies.
Right.
We are still very suspicious of foreign investments.
So far, Prime Minister Modi has shown that he's willing and able to open up the economy for foreign investment. And that might be a good...
Right.
And you have some banking. Are you involved in India, in the banking system?
No, banking side, I'm not involved in India. I would like to. But the issue here is that so much control as to how much investment can be made.
And how much profit can be taken. But these are the areas in which I think things will get better after the visit of our Prime Minister to United States. So let's hope India-US relations will look better, and you will be involved very much in it on a personal basis. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
ഈ വിദേശ വിചാരം ഇവിടെ പൂർണ്ണമാകുന്നു. മറ്റൊരു അധ്യായവുമായി നമുക്ക് വീണ്ടും കാണാം അടുത്തയാഴ്ച ഇതേ സമയം ഇതേ ചാനലിൽ. നമസ്കാരം.